You are now locked in and listening to The Issue.
This guy is a franchise quarterback, and no, I don't want to hear any pushback on that.
It feels like a top 10 roster to me. It feels like it can win a championship.
This is The Issue.
Yo, what's up? We are back. It is The Issue. It is Thursday, December 8th, and we have another episode here for you today. So it's a pretty loaded one. A lot of news in the NFL, right? Quarterbacks going down this last week in week 13.
Yeah.
So teams kind of trying to find some answers. Mm-hmm. The Rams go out and they sign Baker. That'll be coming up first here. Tim will have a rant on that.
Pick him up off waivers. One point they're going to inherit the rest of his salary, which is like $1.35 million for the rest of the year. So seems like a lot, doesn't it?
It does.
They're 3-9.
It does.
3-9. It's awesome.
I mean, was it to kind of keep the division rivals from getting a shot at him? We'll get
That's
to all of that.
That's actually interesting. Yeah. I didn't even think about that.
To finish out the first segment, though, we'll have hits and misses like normal. And then into the second segment, we will have week 13 review, and we will give you our list of the current top 10 quarterbacks in the NFL. So current list going into week 14, what we expect to see for the rest of the season, and then an accumulation of the season.
Right, of just this year's performance, by the way.
Right, not all time. And then in the third segment, we will finish things off with week 14 predictions and bets on a budget. We're going to kind of throw those into the same timing, I guess, this week, because the end is reserved for kind of a discussion slash rant on college football and everything that's been going on there with the transfer portal. Things have been absolutely nuts.
Insane. You know, obviously you got Dion going to Colorado, Phil Dracovic, hometown kid, coming back home, playing for Pitt.
That's going
to
be awesome.
That's going to be sweet. That's going to be sweet. But so we'll start, like you said, with Baker Mayfield, right? Gets picked up by the Rams. I mean, I'm not gonna sit here and fault Baker, right? I get it 100% on his end, right? Work is work. You found somebody to pay your $1.35 million, right? You know, like you found work. You're able to play football, play the game you love, right? I get it on Baker's end. I'm not blaming him at all. And, right, I'm somebody who doesn't really like Baker at all. But this isn't his fault per se, right? That's not my problem with the move on his end. But if you're the Rams, I got to ask. I mean, what's going on here, right? I'm not sure I've ever seen a weirder, like a stranger season from a Super Bowl winner. I mean, I guess some might have seen it coming, right? They weren't dominant last year. Let's not act like they tore through the NFC, right? So let's start with their playoff run last year, right? They almost lost to the Bucks, right? It wasn't like a comfortable win. You know, they were up a lot, and then a couple fumbles, a couple turnovers late. Next thing you know, the Bucks are like within a possession. Now it's tied, and you're like, oh, okay, yeah. And then they just heave one up to Cooper Kupp, and he kind of saves the day, right? Like, that was a very losable game. Or how about against the Niners and Jimmy G? Well, they got outplayed for like three quarters, and then Jimmy G and the Niners defense completely imploded, and then Cooper Kupp bailed them out again, because that's kind of what happens. Probably should have lost that game, though. And then how about the Bengals in the Super Bowl? The Bengals had that game. They were the better team for most of the football game, I would say. And then that last drive, you get, you know, Cooper Kupp end-arounds and Cooper Kupp sweeps and Cooper Kupp down the middle. And then Aaron Donald, obviously, with the sack, saves it. And I said this going into the season. I said, be careful with the whole, like, bring the band back together thing. Like, be careful paying aging veterans, like, you know, Aaron Donald, who I think is still fine. He's still been fine. And then going out and getting Bobby Wagner and Allen Robinson. And I'm not saying I don't like Stafford, but I think we went a little bit crazy with his extension. And, you know, he's the best. They went a little crazy there for a hot second, right? So the Rams are signing Baker Mayfield. Baker Mayfield is one of the worst quarterbacks in the game over the last three seasons, right? There's three main seasons he's played, right? When he's pressured. Actually, this year he's worse than 32nd. He's not even technically a starting quarterback against the Blitz. I think he's like 35th. How about over the last 3 years, he's actually bottom five in Jared Goff territory. He's down there with like Jared Goff and rookie quarterbacks like Zach Wilson and Kenny Pickett, right? Like young second year quarterbacks, rookie quarterbacks, right? And I'm not saying it's easy to throw from a muddy pocket, right? But go look who's top five against the Blitz. Actually, in the last like five games, Kenny Pickett's starting to figure it out. He's kind of up there in the last like five games, moving his way up. But it's a lot of like Mahomes and Burrow and Brady and Aaron, right? Like guys who get it. They make the right checks at the line. They're slick in the pocket. They don't have to be mobile, right? I don't think any of those guys are hyper mobile. Yeah, Mahomes will move around. Burrow can move around. Aaron can move, but that's not why they're good. They're good within the pocket. Especially like Brady. Slides here, slides left, slides right, steps up. Little shoulder wiggle. Next thing you know, ball's out. Right, ball's out on time. Accurate, in rhythm. The Rams are the third worst in the league this year in sacks allowed. They've allowed 42 sacks. Only the Bears and the Colts are worse, who are hardly functioning organizations. The Bears were up like 19-9 at one point in the second half and lost to Aaron at home. At home. Which they can't block. And now you're going to put a new quarterback who, rumor has it, he might play tonight. A relatively immobile quarterback and a cocky and arrogant one at that. Into a disaster of a wide receiver room. I'll let that be known. He's throwing to almost nobody. Cooper Kupp's hurt. Van Jefferson's still working his way back from injury. Ben Skowronek. Someone named McCutcheon. Come on. Like, that sounds like an absolute disaster. Not to mention the noise and annoyance that he brings. I mean, if you can't admit that he's brought nothing but noise and arrogance and cockiness and just a distraction that you don't need, you're just not paying attention, right? I can't really have a conversation with you if you can deny that he hasn't been all those things. I mean, like, he calls out the medical staff in Cleveland, and he's now called out wide receivers and coaches in both Cleveland and Carolina. Right, and I said this whenever he was with Cleveland in the last year, and he was starting to get really, really pushy when he wasn't playing well. And I said, Baker, you got to relax because this is the best job you're ever going to have. Right, and if you can't make this work, how is a roster that's not as good as Cleveland, which at the time of him leaving Cleveland, not a lot of rosters were better than Cleveland. That was a top five roster. That was, they had just traded for Amari Cooper, but that was, you know, you had OBJ, Jarvis Landry, two good tight ends, two good backs, a really good line. Myles Garrett, Denzel Ward, some decent linebackers, right? Like, that's a good roster. And I said, be careful messing this up because somebody with a worth roster, if you can't perform with that, with a really good running game, coach of the year, then why is a team with a worse roster going to bring in and expect that to work? And I said, you got to be a guy in the room. You can't be going out and calling out medical staffs. Like, who does that? I've never seen that in my entire... Tyrod Taylor got his lung punctured 20 minutes before an NFL football game, lost the starting job, has not started a game since. I've never heard him say a word about the medical staff. Not one. And not to mention, Baker is not this good. Right? He's not good enough to overcome him being... I can't even say the word, right? Of him being an idiot. We'll just say that, right? I mean, P.J. Walker started him over at some point this year. P.J. Walker was in the XFL at one point, or the AAF or something like that, one of these spring football leagues. Sam Darnold started over him. Does anybody really think Sam Darnold's a good starting quarterback? I'd go a step further. I think the Rams should look for a reboot, not to patchwork their quarterback room to win, what, six games this year? I said this in, like, week seven. I'm like, you should have unloaded probably Jalen Ramsey and probably one more piece. And you probably could have gotten a first and, like, a number three or four receiver. I mean, this morning, ask yourself, Jalen Ramsey, who just got crisped by DK Metcalf to win the game this past week, right? Him or a first-round pick and another receiver. I think at this stage, you're what? You're 3-9? I'd go for probably the first and the receiver, but it's too late now. Penny deadline's over. Right, so here they are with minimal picks, minimal capital, and now a Baker Mayfield issue. He's not an issue yet, but we all know he's going to be, right? We all know he's going to be death taxes and Baker Mayfield being an idiot. Right? That's kind of the thing. So to me, this makes no sense. So they can go win, what, two more games than they would have with John Wolford? I mean, who cares? Roll it with Wolford and Perkins or whoever. Right? Cheap, easy in the room. They're not going to agitate your entire locker room. I don't understand this. It's a good culture bringing in somebody that does not fit into culture, is not good with cultures. I would want no parts of Baker Mayfield, especially as a team that actually, I'm not saying they have momentum. I was at 3-9, but I mean, they just won a championship. They're not that far removed from being a really good team. They still have stars. So Stafford's hurt. Cooper Kupp's hurt. Okay, it's a reboot year. Reboot. Get rid of pieces that aren't working. It's pretty easy to see Jalen Ramsey's not working anymore. Reboot. Get rid of him. Get a pick. Go get capital. Right? Why, like, what is this? We're going to go pay Baker a $1.4 million over the next, what, six games? Just to be annoying and probably not very productive? That's terrible. That doesn't make any sense to me. It doesn't make any sense to me.
No. And the thing that I'm kind of looking out for and projecting is, look, you just took somebody who is drama-filled and you put them in the most drama-filled city and place around every big star.
That's a great point. That's a great point.
Like, if you're looking, an analogy, you don't take an alcoholic to the bar.
Right.
You just took Baker Mayfield to Los Angeles.
Somebody that's a month off of, you know, going to AA, you don't take them as your DD, right? No. You know, they're not going bar hopping to DD you home, right? I get what you mean.
And I mean, I just see that being such a problem. There's going to be so many personality clashes. I mean, if you're clashing with people in Cleveland,
yeah. Well, it's not
wait till you roll up to LA.
It's not like you're an Indy. Let's go with hits and misses. Hit number one. So I guess we'll start in Indy then. I said like a month ago, I said the Colts may be a bottom five organization in the league right now. I seriously think so. And it's crazy because I thought they were stable, right? I thought they were, you know, like a really solid organization. But since Andrew Luck retired, they've been awful, awful. I mean, they've had three long-term quarterbacks, really right? Bad, like more than a year, right? Where you go in to the year knowing that that's your starter, right? I'm not counting people that are come in for injury or backups or Sam Ehlinger, right?
Like just rotational guys.
Two of them, you know, Rivers and Wentz both had a winning record. And then Jacoby Brissett was one game under 500. They moved off all three of them. They got and hired Jeff Saturday, making questionable personnel decisions. I think they're awful. I think Irsay sucks, and I think they're going to be garbage for another this year and then two more years. I can't see them having a winning record for the next 3 years.
Well, look, if Matt Ryan can't get it done with that offensive line, and look, they don't have a ton of weapons, but they have enough for a Matt Ryan, a veteran guy,
you'd think.
To make some reads, to make some throws. He has looked awful.
He's not good. No, he's not good. Miss number one here. The Falcons are generally able to kind of run the football, especially at home, and kind of grind their way to some victories. And Mariota, off a play fake, is really a really solid quarterback. He can run it himself. And the Steelers generally aren't a great run defense. That's not normally our strength. But when we're healthy, you know, when Cam Hayward's playing well, they can be. And that was kind of the case this weekend. But we both picked the Falcons because I expected them to run the football, but they just could not get anything going. Steelers rode a fantastic first half. To the victory in Atlanta. I just expected Atlanta to be able to run the football.
Yeah. I we'll talk about this game more in depth in the second segment when we go through the review. But, I mean, yes, I did not expect a Pittsburgh defense to play an Atlanta running game like that and excel in any means.
Hit number two, we said it last year, right, when Tyler Huntley came in and played for Lamar when Lamar was hurt. He played well, and I said it then, and I'll say it again. I like Lamar, and I think Lamar is better. But this isn't a quarterback-dependent offense. I said it's a run game-dependent, offensive line-dependent, culture-dependent team. And any quarterback that has a little bit of wiggle can operate pretty well.
And I think Huntley and Lamar have a very similar game,
though. Absolutely. They both run around a lot, can extend the play. Good throwers, not great. And I'm not saying that Lamar isn't better than Tyler Huntley, right? Lamar is better than Tyler Huntley. But I don't think the gap is miles. I said it then, and I'll say it again. I don't think the gap is miles between them.
Yes. I 100% agree with that. I mean, I was watching the game. First of all, I was just upset that Lamar got yanked and only scored 1 point in fantasy.
Well, got hurt, but yeah.
But I was watching, you know, the rest of the highlights when they would cut to it on Red Zone. And, I mean, I don't notice much of a difference between
If you put him in a number 8 jersey, would you even know?
No, I don't think so. I don't think so.
I mean,
so.
Just maybe. But still, right. It
purely based off the way they play and the way
very similar.
They move the pocket, they
very similar.
They have a lot of the same tendencies. Yeah. And I think that offense was built that way, so they don't have to be quarterback dependent.
Right, absolutely. Miss number two here. So we had the Chiefs above the Bengals in our rankings, and maybe they are better overall. But something about that matchup is really, really tough for Kansas City. Mm-hmm. There's a little bit of a Brady feel with Burrow that, like, no matter who he's up against, I'm not sure I can sleep okay on Saturday night knowing that I put money against Joe Burrow, right?
Yeah.
He's got that effect where it's fourth quarter, you're down, and it does. I feel like it doesn't matter.
Well, he just wins.
He just wins. That's a great way to put it. He just wins. I don't know what it is about that matchup, but Kansas City can't beat Cincinnati.
It's almost like one of those things where Pittsburgh just couldn't beat New England for the longest time.
Oh,
like,
my God.
You just get a team in your conference, and you just can't beat them for a couple of years. And yeah. I think that's kind of what we're going to start to see.
Right. And that was for a long time, Lamar against Kansas City, and they haven't played in a while. But first couple of years, right, when Lamar was, like, really, really dynamic, and Mahomes really dynamic, and they had a couple wild battles. All right, hit number three, yet another winning week of bets here. Look, wake up, people. We're back. We are 6-6 on the year, right? So we took a week off. That's right, 500. We've now ripped off, what, 4 weeks in a row, I think?
That
something
feels
like
good.
That.
Yes.
We are indeed that guy. We are built like that. 6-6 on the year, finally back to 500. I think we started 2-6 and ripped off 4 weeks in a row now. And of course, we'll give you another winning week in the third segment while we're going through our predictions. We'll just, you know, mention the lines that we like as we hit that game. But yeah, another winning week of bets. It's just what we do at this point.
We caught our momentum. Wake up. We are it's rolling us. Now through the back half of the season, just like we said we would.
We are them.
Just like we said we would.
We are him. We are them. That's us.
Yeah, I like that.
Miss number three here.
Yeah.
I lost the week on predictions. Luke is still in it, technically.
He's still breathing.
I'm one win away from clinching. One win away. But yeah, as of now, you are still in it. You are 5-8. I'm 8-5. I need that one dub. I feel good about my picks this week, but who knows? Who knows?
I'm just, you know, week by week, we're just trying to survive out here. I am still plugged into the machine. Don't get me, don't get that wrong whatsoever. I still got IVs, stuff dripping in and out.
You're good. You're still on life support.
I am trying to battle my way back. And,
All right.
This just hasn't been my year. At least we got a winning week this week, so we're going to try to build on that. I mean, I got to win out, so.
So there's not that. This week has a lot of, like, I don't want to say lopsided games, but on paper, relatively lopsided, right? Like Philly and the Giants. Yeah. I mean, do we think the Giants are that level? No. Like,
I don't think so.
Dallas and Houston. Like, I don't think Houston really stands a chance. Even tonight, right? The Raiders playing really good football. Going to the Rams. Like, the Rams are. If Baker starts, I mean, it doesn't matter who starts, really, but there's some lopsided games, but there are a couple close ones, and hey, good for us. We're split on those close ones.
Yeah, it'll be interesting. Guys, stick around for the second segment, though. We will go over week 13, and we will give you our top 10 quarterbacks going into week 14. So, not going to want to miss it.
All right, second segment on a Thursday. God, it's already December 8th.
I know, it's crazy.
It is officially Christmas season, so I've now, we're 8 days in. I've now watched the Griswold Family Vacation probably 3 or 4 times.
Well, that's a staple. I have to.
Haven't actually seen Elf yet, which is kind of sad. I've already watched It's a Wonderful Life, I think, twice. Got to get the classics in there.
I haven't gotten to that one.
And it's kind of upsetting. I haven't seen Elf yet, so I'll probably do that before, you know, by the end of the weekend, right?
I got like...
Because that's criminal at that point. It's just criminal. Even if I have it on in the background while I'm you know, cleaning or whatever, yeah. Elf is an absolute staple.
Yeah.
I have to hit... I would say a minimum of 3 Elf watches per season. I think that's a fair amount.
Mm-hmm. You don't exceed 5. 5 is maximum.
5's too much, yeah. For me, I don't think there is a max on the Griswold because...
I'll watch that 10, 15 times a year.
And so I start early because I need to brush up on it, on my quotes, before I get together with all the uncles and stuff that for Thanksgiving and then subsequently Christmas because
before Thanksgiving.
Yeah, because we quote Griswold like it's a lot it's almost too much, but I gotta brush up on it so I can, you know,
I understand that.
You know what I mean? So my banter for the holidays is on point.
See, I got Christmas Vacation, I got Elf,
and okay, like, those are your main two.
And the last 30% of Polar Express I caught.
Okay. I do like a good Polar Express.
That's about the extent of it so far.
Right.
We do have a lot of good football to talk this segment.
Yeah,
though.
We do. Yeah, yeah. So we're, you know, we're just so we're gonna review some of the bigger games here. Oh, we're just gonna act like that didn't happen. so some bigger games, and then we have our top 10 NFL quarterbacks. We'll take a break, then we'll predict subsequently bets on a budget in the same kind of vein there, I guess.
Yeah.
For lack of a better term. And then I'm gonna get a little bit of a rant going on college football again because it's just crazy right now. It's the transfer portal, Deion's moving. So we're a lot to talk about there, and then we'll kind of discuss the future of college football and probably even get into a little bit of playoff talk there as well. So let's start with the Steelers at the Falcons. First of all, I mentioned this in Hits and Misses. I thought the Falcons were able to run the football, and they kind of did in the second half a little bit. That's why you saw them make a comeback.
Yes.
But I think at that point it was a little bit too little too late. And so when the Steelers needed stops early in the, you know, second quarter, which is usually when the Falcons could start turning up, right? Second quarter, late second quarter, into the early of the third quarter is when they really thrive on their running game.
Mm-hmm.
And we were able to hold them when it counted, right? Obviously late in the game, they started getting it going a little bit, but then Minka comes up clutch with a pick. What did you think, though, of Kenny Pickett's performance?
Honestly, he looked pretty good. His stat line, 16 for 28, 197 yards, touchdown, no picks, 91 QBR. Yeah. So, I mean, he looked good. And he did distribute the football well. He was making good reads. He didn't really make any big mistakes. His throws were accurate. He looked like he had some zip on the ball. I mean, he's starting to look more...
like an NFL quarterback?
Like an NFL starter.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Right.
He's starting to have a little bit of those experiences. He's starting to make the better reads. I mean, I watched him go through a complete read and back to the first guy that he was originally looking at.
That's impressive, yeah.
And be able to move the pocket and make good throws. So he actually impressed me. The thing that didn't was how the Steelers' playbook kind of collapsed again in the second half.
That's now, what, the third or fourth straight week?
Fourth week in a row.
Really nice first half.
Yep.
So the game plan's there, and then just really limited second half. And so here's what's, I guess, promising about that, and here's what's problematic about that. What's promising is, I think, is Kenny is getting really good at mastering the game plan and executing those first 20 scripted plays, right? Those first 20 scripted plays, Kenny is really, really solid at.
Yeah.
Now, the adjusting on the fly and third quarter adjustments might not be there yet. That's fine, right? We need to start, you know what I mean? That needs to start getting corrected. You can't just score 16 in the first half and then just be like, well, if we get a field goal in the second half, we'll be in business.
Yeah,
like, that's not going to fly.
No. And, you know, being able to capitalize on drives, too, is a big one. I mean, you don't have Boswell. I think that's starting to show a little bit. Like, and now when
that Matt Wright, whatever, has been doing okay.
Yeah, but when he's jogging out there, I don't feel the same confidence that I do in the legend of Boz.
Okay, let's talk a little bit of Bengals Chiefs. So I think this might have been one of the most interesting games. This is a 425 game. Where was this, 425?
Yes, it was. It was a 425 game.
Yeah. I think it was Romo and Nance game of the week,
mm-hmm.
Which rightfully so. I'm back and forth between... I think they're two of the top three teams. I think Buffalo's in there as well. I'm not sure the order.
Yeah.
You could pick the order, and you could have a really, really solid argument for any of them being one, two, or three. Here's the thing that I will say, though, is Kansas City's defense is serviceable except for against Joe Burrow.
I was going to say the story of the game is Joe Burrow. I
mean, he just finds a way to pick them apart.
And his completion percentage is crazy.
What did he complete?
25 for 31, 286, two touchdowns, no picks, 127 QBR. And then, I mean, P. Ryan looked great on the ground, too. He added 108 yards. He didn't score a touchdown. Joe Burrow actually added a rushing touchdown, too.
So, but what you brought up about Joe Burrow is the accuracy.
Yeah.
And I think, so, there's two parts to accuracy, and it's, can you throw the ball, like, I don't want to say accurately, right? That's defining word with a word, but putting the ball where it needs to be on that receiver. But
right.
Then the second component to that is it going to the right spot to begin with, right? Are you throwing
it
to the right
seat? Is it
the
correct
read? Is it the correct read? Is it on time? And then finally, is it on point, right? Is it the right read, on time, on point? And I think, he's on point a lot. That's fine. That's great. I think where he shines is it's on time.
Mm-hmm.
And it's always to the right read. It's almost always to the right read. That's where I think Joe Burrow sets himself apart. Very Brady-esque.
We were watching the Sunday night game, and I forget what quarterback it was, but he made a throw.
It was either Matt Ryan or Dak.
I think it was Matt Ryan.
That was the Sunday night game.
He's like, if you throw that a second and a half earlier, that's a catch. Matt Ryan was just making bad reads.
Yeah, I think it was.
I think it was Matt Ryan. I mean, it fits the bill. He had, three picks?
Something like that.
Yeah.
Because it wasn't on time. It wasn't on time. Route almost got jumped. Almost went for six the other way, right? All right, how about Miami at San Francisco? So, let's start with the Jimmy G thing, right? Tough news. He's hurt. Out for the year. Could come back for playoffs if rehab goes well. 7-8 weeks is what Schefter's saying. That's good news because it was initially out for the year.
Right, that would have been detrimental.
That's a problem, but we've always said San Fran's not a quarterback-centric offense, much like Baltimore isn't.
Yeah.
It's run-centric. Defense is really, really solid. The scheme is better than the quarterback in this instance with Jimmy, Brock, no matter who's at quarterback. Here is what this game told me. It told me more about Tua and kind of confirmed my thoughts. I think Tua and Miami, they're a lot like Dallas, right? If you're not a good football team and you have a shaky quarterback, you're screwed.
Yeah.
And Tua can handle those games, and they are going to absolutely boat race somebody with either an average defense or an average quarterback almost every time. I mean, go look at their record. Their four losses are against four good quarterbacks, yeah. Right? Same thing with Dallas, right? Dallas, whenever you get Indianapolis limping in, of course you're going to smack them, right? So same thing with Miami. I think they're going to be fine against 90% of the league. I think they are too far away, though, from the top 10%.
Yes, where they're going to not be able to get deep into the playoffs.
Right. That's what it told me. That's what that game told me. What about you?
You took the words out of my mouth. For the notes for this game, I had written down, QB play not great, .. Great schemes and running game, though.
It was almost Shanahan versus Shanahan. It was like the same scheme.
It was really impressive. It was exciting to watch. It was a really good watch. I think when you get coaches of that caliber playing each other, it's going to be very interesting just because you're seeing things that the rest of the NFL, it's almost like when you watch teams like this with coaches like this, you're seeing what the NFL as a league will look like in like 5-10 years because eventually that's the new trend. It's going to start pushing in that direction. It's just really, it's fascinating.
You already see that tree starting to take over, right? So it started with obviously Mike Shanahan, Kyle Shanahan's dad.
Yeah.
And now it's Shanahan, and then it splits into, like, so it's Kyle, then it splits into McVay, LaFleur, now Kevin O'Connell, mm-hmm. right? Zach Taylor is coming from that tree. Now Mike McDaniel, right? Even Robert Saleh, who's defensive, you still see a lot of the same core values,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
Good, stout, fundamental defense. Even if you don't have a lot of talent, you're going to be fundamentally sound. You're going to be a tough defense.
Even a Brian Daboll.
And a good run game.
Yeah.
Brian Daboll, similarly. Now, Daboll's not from that tree, but you see a lot of similar characteristics.
Moving
right?
in that direction.
Right, and so I think you're right. I think the run game's making a renaissance because of what it can open up in the pass game.
Yeah.
And these guys are, like, I guess, pioneers for the renaissance of the run game.
And you just look at our top 10 quarterbacks. You just glance through that list. All those quarterbacks are fantastic off of play action. So having a great running game is going to set that up over the top, too. So.
That is almost always the case, yeah. So actually, without further ado, you mentioned the top 10 quarterbacks. You know, why keep teasing it? Let's just get into it. Let's go top 10 quarterbacks up through this point just based off this season. Obviously, if it was all time, Tom would be number one. That's not the case. We're going just off this season up through, what, week 13
yeah.
now, not including injured quarterbacks. So let's get into it. We'll start at number 10. All right, so let's start with Derek Carr at 10. I know a lot of people don't like Derek Carr. He's not super flashy. First of all, he wins. Right, I know they started out rocky. Look, new coach, and how many different systems has he now been in? Like four?
Yeah.
Four or five?
Yes.
I mean, he's had so many different coordinators and coaches. So yeah, it takes him a little bit of time. Now that he is on the same page with not only Josh McDaniels and Devontae Adams, it's really starting to click, right? See, what, 250 yards a game, 92 pass rating, right? That's big boy football right there.
Yeah, it is.
That's good football. I'm not saying that he's great, but that's top 10 football.
It is. And
plus, he's been winning a lot recently.
In that connection, like you said, I mean, Derek Carr and Devontae Adams, I think it has the ability to become a top one in the league. It's not there right now. It's not at the very top among the most elite.
It's getting
but
there.
It is getting there, and they're starting to gel more and more. So I think the end of this season will look pretty good with Derek Carr, and I think next season, if they can keep some stability in there for probably like the first time in his career,
right.
I think that would be beneficial.
Let's go with number 9 here. Let's go with Tua. Now, I know a lot of people are going to say it's low, so I like it. Like 21 touchdowns, 5 picks. Love that. Love that. Really, really solid. Leads the league in pass rating at 112. That's all good and well. He's at like 286 yards a game. Fine. But I'm looking right here. Let's go look against winning teams, right? So you go look at their losses. Cincinnati, how'd he play? 8-for-14. Now, granted, he got hurt. Some people might say, though, that's not his fault. Like, I'm just saying it's not his fault. But it's a product of what he is. He's undersized, and he's not super mobile.
Yes.
And you see, look, how about against San Francisco? 2 touchdowns, 2 picks, pass rating of 79.
Like, it's right, just so very middle of the road.
Very, very middle of the road. You go look at against all these really good teams, even against Pittsburgh, right? 1 touchdown, no picks, 92 pass rating, right? So not quite as prolific as you're used to seeing.
That's kind of like right around where Kenny Pickett was this past week for Pittsburgh.
Absolutely, right? So, yeah, if you're looking for a comparison, right?
That would be it.
Kenny Pickett from this past week. Good, certainly good, not special, though. And I think that's where Tua ends up shaking out. So when you look at like talent and against good teams. All right, let's go to number 8 here. Let's go with Dak Prescott. So I like that since he's come back from being hurt. He's still finding ways to win and be super productive. 13 touchdowns, 7 picks. Don't love how many picks he has.
Yeah.
But granted, he was hurt, so he hasn't been in a lot of games, and he's kind of been working his way back. So I'll give him the benefit of the doubt there. 96 pass rating. The reason he's over Tua is I've seen him play really well against good teams. Where, like, the Giants have a fairly legit defense. He's got a 91 pass rating. Now, again, not special, a lot like Tua. That's kind of why he's lower on the list, because not special. You go look, how about Minnesota? 139 pass rating. Minnesota's got a real defense, right? They got a good pass rush. Secondary's been pretty good. Even Detroit. Now I know that their defense isn't great, but the pass rush is there. 113 pass rating. Like, so he's been fairly good against good pass rushes, good defenses.
Yeah, and it's better than years past. We've seen him really, really struggle against top competition.
Yeah.
So I think
he's getting better.
It should be a breath of fresh air for any Cowboys fans out there.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. All right, let's go with number 7 here, Geno Smith. Look, I didn't want to believe it either, but I have to. At this point, we gotta be honest about this.
When we were making this list, we sat down and we were like, okay, we got to 6, and then we got to 7, and we're, okay, who do we put here? And the names that were being thrown around, and the fact that Geno Smith is the 7th best quarterback in the league right now, nobody would have predicted that coming into this season. Nobody.
Well, I think he's 3rd in pass rating. He's 1st in completion percentage. He's 22 touchdowns to 6 picks. That's, like, I think 4th in the league.
Look, unless your show is called the Geno Smith Show, you didn't predict this.
No. And here's the thing that's also fairly impressive. Look, I like DK too, but I think he's on the lower end of wide receiver ones. And I don't personally view Lockett as a 2. I think he's too undersized. I think he's too inconsistent. I think he's more of a high-end 3. They don't have a tight end presence that I'm comfortable with. And the emergence of Kenneth Walker, that's helped him a lot, but that wasn't always steady, especially at the beginning of the year when he was slinging it around. He's working with all new pieces up front. Well, not all, but mostly new pieces up front.
And an aging coach.
Two rookies and an aging defensive head coach. Look, Geno deserves a lot of credit. I think Shane Waldron, the offensive coordinator, also deserves a lot of credit. He's done a fantastic job. But and I've been in denial, but you got to call it what it is. 109 pass rating, leads the league in completion percentage. That's good quarterback
and
play.
And he's led a team that shouldn't have this many wins to this many wins. So
I agree.
I think that's a feat in itself.
Let's go with number 6. Let's go with Kirk Cousins here. So Kirk is in my eyes, slightly better. Right, so now, right now his completion percentage isn't quite as high as it normally is. It's 65. He's more usually around 67 to 69, generally speaking. So that's a little bit different for Kirk. Yards are down a bit, and the pass rating is only 88. Here's what I love, though. In big moments, he's been fantastic, which is really, really not like Kirk. Take the Philly game away.
Yes.
Fourth quarter against Buffalo, fantastic. Right, late against the Jets was really, really good. I know it's only 18 touchdowns, 9 picks. I think the leadership, though, that he is providing, getting the ball to the right places when it counts, basically Justin Jefferson when it counts, has been huge. Now, look, I can hear the argument for Geno over Kirk. Here's what's big for me, though, is wins and losses. I don't think you can judge a career for a quarterback based on wins and losses, but I think season to season, it's a very, very valid quarterback stat to look at.
Yes.
And I think it is.
And I would say even more so for Kirk, is he's doing it in the NFC North. We know how hard it is for the Minnesota Vikings to finish over top of Green Bay in the NFC North.
It's been a struggle for a long time. So, and look, we bang on the Packers, but they're not a bad team.
No, they are not. They're a very good, stable organization that's done it well for a lot of years. And I just think that's a little more impressive than Geno Smith kind of dominating the NFC West, which is just a kind of lower division right now.
I mean, look at, I'm just going to read Kirk. This is against divisional opponents. 119 pass rating, 94, 96. I know the Buffalo game was a 72 overall, but fourth quarter pass rating, 97.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, how about New England? Really tough defense. Belichick owns bad quarterbacks. 116, right? So, I mean, go look at either divisional games or big games. They've been fantastic. They've been fantastic. Kirk has, rather. All right, let's go to number 5, Justin Herbert. First of all, he's an athletic freak. I think he might be the most talented quarterback in the league, like when it comes to size, can move, big arm, really, really smart at the line of scrimmage. There's nothing really that he can't do at this point as a young quarterback. 20 touchdowns, 7 picks. And here's the thing. Here's how you know you have a quarterback. When you go into the game in the season knowing if it doesn't work, it's the coach's fault, not the quarterback's fault. That's how you know.
Yeah. Yeah, you know you got a guy when that's the case. I mean, we've seen him do it all year, and I think he's now become him and Josh Allen are kind of the measuring stick of what a quarterback should look like.
If you're looking for a franchise changing quarterback, that's who you're looking for.
Big arm, can move really well.
Good leader.
Adds to the rush.
Yeah.
Fantastic leaders, both of them.
Yeah.
But especially Justin Herbert in this slot. I mean, he's been able to elevate a receiving core that has been injury riddled throughout the last couple of seasons.
It's been awful.
Lacking talent at many times, he's been able to elevate things. So Justin Herbert at five makes a lot of sense.
I think he might be my favorite quarterback. I mean, look at
it's either him or that dude we got at three for me.
Yeah, three.
Yeah.
All right, we'll get to that. So we got to make a little pissed up at four here. Let's go Jalen Hurts at four. So I think moving forward that Justin Herbert's a better quarterback and certainly a more talented quarterback, right? Especially throwing the football.
Yes.
But I can't argue with Jalen Hurts' production. First of all, through the air only, 20 touchdowns, 3 picks. That's number one in the league in interception, touchdown interception ratio. 108 pass rating. Unbelievable. 245 yards a game. Not special, but certainly good enough.
Yeah.
Certainly capable. That's not even counting rushing, which is just out of this world. How many touchdowns does he add rushing? 9 more touchdowns rushing. So overall, he's what? 29 touchdowns, 3 picks.
Yeah.
Doesn't have a fumble. A fumble loss, that is. Look, that's exactly what you're looking for in a franchise quarterback. And also 11-1. I just got done saying how crucial in my eyes from season to season a quarterback record is. He's 11-1. 11-1.
It's impressive. And I think one thing that has to be examined is the steps or are the steps that he's taken just from last year. The progression that we've seen speaks a lot, especially in the NFL. When you can do it that quick and progress that quickly, that's stuff that we've seen from like Mahomes and Josh Allen, right? Where you come out in your year two, year three, and it's just you just keep going up and up and up. And he's not seeming to hit a plateau. So
wasn't Tennessee supposed to have this really good defense? 130 pass rating last week.
Yeah, they were supposed to.
How about
to.
Indianapolis, who's had a pretty good defense? 107. Right, like Pittsburgh, good defense, 141.
It's impressive.
Really, Dallas, juggernaut, 105. Like, that's called big boy quarterback
yes.
right there.
Yes.
I mean, that's impressive. Even in the games where he doesn't play all that well, 73. Oh, never mind, his rushing numbers are up. He's good. Right? Like, so it's impressive how many different ways he can beat you.
Yes.
All right, you said number three here, Josh Allen at number three.
Yes.
I think what makes him special is his big play ability. I mean, they're at any point 75 yards down the field, can throw a dart. I mean, on a line.
Yeah.
It's really impressive. He does things where you can't really wrap your head around it. 25 touchdowns. I don't love the 11 picks. I think he kind of got out of whack there for a little bit, but he's steered it back onto the tracks. 284 yards a game, a 96 pass rating. He's got the longest play of the year, 98 yards.
I mean, it's not always – yes, you don't like to see a high number of picks, but the times he's throwing the picks aren't very, like, costly times to throw an interception. They're more, I don't want to ever say an interception was good, but they're better than what it could have been. Like a late fourth quarter you're trying to drive.
Right.
You don't see many of those from him. And plus, just – when an entire team and organization leans on him every single week and he's able to go out and deliver, be the leading rusher, the leading passer, and probably leading touchdowns too. So
here's another thing that he's top five in the league in on-target throw percentage, right?
Yeah.
74% of the time, he is on target. And his knock has always been accuracy. I think we can say that that's not a factor anymore.
Yeah, you can put some white out over that one.
Yeah, you can put some white out over that one. You're good to go. All right, number two, let's go with Patrick Mahomes. 105 passer rating. He leads the league with 317 yards per game. He leads the league with 30 touchdowns, only 8 picks. Leads the league in yards. So he's first in yards, yards per game, touchdowns. He's top 5 in passer rating. What more do you want from him? I mean, all new receivers, new offensive line last year, didn't matter.
Lost his number one receiver in Tyreek, and just, it's fine.
It just doesn't matter. Over the last 2 years, they've rebuilt his offensive line and his receiving core, and it just doesn't matter. You want to talk about on-target throws? He's at 76% on-target throws, so he's getting the ball where it needs to be, on time, in rhythm, on target. What can't he do, really?
Yeah,
what can he? And I know it sounds cliche, but What can he do?
I haven't seen many limitations on Mahomes yet. But there's one dude that seems to have his number.
Cool as a cucumber, Joe Burr. Yes. Joe Burr at number one. Here's the thing. I just saw him outplay Mahomes. And here's what I saw him when I saw him outplay Mahomes in the fourth quarter, is even more impressive.
For the third time.
For the third time in a row. He's got a 104 pass rating, 290 yards roughly a game, 25 touchdowns, 8 picks.
That's impressive.
And like I said, we always talk about that on target. 78% of his throws are on target, right? And so, like I said, that comes with being right there. That on target, that's not just that ball needs to where is where it, you know, where you should put it in the hands, right? No, it's on time, in rhythm, within the structure of the play, going to the right read, going to the right guy, attacking the right matchup.
And getting
checking the right blitz,
yes.
Right? Or checking the right protection to counter the blitz, right? All of it goes into that for you to be able to have a clean pocket, to get that ball out on time and put it where it needs to be. Wildly impressive.
And he's done a fantastic job with
it. And he wins. He wins better than almost anybody I've seen. To be able to overcome, right? You lose Jamar Chase for like a month. Joe Mixon's been out for like 3 games with a concussion. Defense is a hit or miss. Offensive line is still not as good as you'd like it to be. Doesn't really matter. Doesn't matter. Yep. We'll just beat Mahomes. It's okay. We'll just go 4-0 without Jamar Chase. Like it's ridiculous.
Insanity.
At this point.
But I'm gonna run back through this list for you guys here. We got the Derek Carr sitting at 10, Tua at 9, Dak Prescott at 8, Geno Smith at 7, Kirk Cousins at 6, Justin Herbert at 5, Jalen Hurts in the 4 spot, Josh Allen at 3, Patrick Mahomes at 2. And Joe Burrow, a.k.a. Joe Scheisty or Joe Burr or Joe Cool, at that number one spot going in to week 14 of the NFL. But that is all we have for this segment. We will be right back in a minute. Just going to do all of our predictions here and all of our bets, get you guys the best for week 14 coming up. So don't go anywhere. What's up? We are back. It is The Issue. We are back for the third segment. All predictions. I guess for the first half. Well, this is the first half. So we got week 14 predictions and week 14 bets on a budget up first here in this third segment. And then the third segment will be finished off with a kind of another rant and a little bit of a discussion. And
I'm fired up right now.
Yeah?
I'm fired up.
Yeah. I know you've been pretty ready to
fired
go
up
on this one. So it should definitely be interesting.
Fired up.
I'm excited for our predictions, though. I need to win another week to stay alive here. I need to win out, so obviously that would put this as a must-win week. Going to do everything we can. I mean, I don't know. I've yet to win back-to-back weeks. I was looking at the sheet.
I think that's been big for me, is kind of curbing the momentum. Because once the ball gets rolling, especially now, hey, look, you're playing with house money.
Exactly. I mean, I got
a little. I could get a little tense, start picking some crazy picks.
Nothing to lose. I mean, that would be.
I don't think I'm there yet, but.
No. You know. That would be.
But another win, you never know.
After you clinch, yeah. I mean.
Right.
Then it is what it is. But.
All right, let's start it off here. Let's go to the Thursday night football game. The Las Vegas Raiders at the Los Angeles Rams. We're both going to go ahead and take the Raiders here.
Yeah.
I think Baker's starting. I mean, come on.
It's never a good idea to bet on Baker Mayfield.
You're telling me a not good quarterback is going to come to a team that's not good as well and win? I don't see it. And the Raiders are playing good football right now.
They are.
It'd be different. The Raiders also sucked. I'd say they may have a chance, maybe because they're at home.
Yeah.
No, the Raiders are also really bad, too. So I'll go ahead. Or I'm sorry, the Raiders are also playing really well.
Yeah.
Rams are really bad.
Well, the thing is with the Raiders, they're starting to finally catch their.
They're starting to click.
Catch the momentum. They're starting to roll a little bit.
Absolutely. So we're both going to go take the Raiders. Let's go with the Vikings at the Lions. The Lions are actually favored by 2.5.
Which is crazy.
Nuts. That's insane.
Is that home field then, I guess?
I guess. That brings us to our first bet. And since betting the Vikings plus points is not going to net you a whole lot of money, I think they went outright, and they're plus money on the money line. They're plus 114.
Yeah.
So I'd say skip the spread, and I jump right to the money line. So first bet here is plus 114 for the Vikings on the money line. We both are taking the Vikings. Look, I get it. There's spots. They're tough spots in the NFL. I don't really think this is one of them, though. I get they played like a physical game against the Jets, and I know that the Lions just boat raced Jacksonville. But does that mean a lot? Does it now mean a lot in Vegas when you crush the Jags? Because it never has.
I don't think it should.
I don't think it should either.
I'm not sure what that line's on.
I don't know, but I think
I like Vikings.
The Vikings are a significantly more talented team, and I'm going to ride with that.
Just take it outright, yeah.
All right, let's go with the Eagles at the Giants. We're both going to go ahead and take the Eagles here. First of all, though, I think they're a better team. And let's be real, the Giants have kind of lost their way on offense a little bit. They were a primarily running team to start the year. Look, teams know that. You got, 13 weeks of film now. It's just not going, I guess 12 weeks for them. It's just not going as they thought it would at this point in the year. That's fine. They're still 7-4-1, well above 500. They're still a fine team, but they're not on the same level as Philly. I think Philly wins by, two touchdowns probably?
Yeah, I would think so. I don't think it's going to be all that close. I mean, Jalen's playing on a different level right now.
Yeah. Let's go with Houston at Dallas. Again, I said this about Dallas. A weak team that goes into Dallas, that's a hornet's nest. You have no shot. You have no shot. I'm not saying that Houston would win at home, but they at least have a shot. It probably wouldn't be a 17-point spread. 17 points, that's a college spread.
That's a ton of
points. I'm not touching that game because you never know, but I do think Dallas wins fairly easily.
Yes, but the 17 points anywhere in the NFL is tough to swallow.
Let's go with the Ravens at the Steelers. This is in Pittsburgh. I'll go take Pittsburgh because I think Tyler Huntley is going to start for the Ravens. And not that I think the gap between him and Lamar is that big, but I think when you're playing a good defense, especially one that's tough on inexperienced quarterbacks, that's where I run into some trouble.
A little bit picking of disaster Tyler Huntley. There.
Right. We know what Tomlin's record is and that defense's record is against inexperienced quarterbacks, so I'll take the Steelers at home.
I like the Steelers, too. If this was away in Baltimore, I'd have to think about it for a while. Yeah. And, you know, the Steelers' defense plays incredibly well at home. And I think T.J. Watt should start to get back to his normal self. He hasn't recorded a sack yet since he came back from
He had that pick against Burrow. He's still impacting the game.
Yeah, he just needs to – we need to get some more quarterback pressures.
Yeah, I'm with that. Browns at the Bengals. We're both going to take the Bengals here. I think they might be the best team in football right now. What they're able to do on the ground that complements Joe Burrow has been really impressive.
Yeah, to supplement that passing game with something to break it up. I mean, you can't let NFL defenses just run after Burrow all day because their offensive line isn't built to take that either, though.
I agree. All right, let's go with the Jets at the Bills. I think we're both going to take the Bills here. Jets are fine, but do I trust Mike White to go into Buffalo? That's a tough spot.
Yeah.
In Buffalo? I don't know.
In front of Bills Mafia, you're a very inexperienced quarterback playing a defensive head coach in Brian Daboll. Like, it's going
to
get...
What, the Bills have won, I think, 3 straight. They're starting to roll a little bit, so we'll go take the Bills here. How about the Jaguars at the Titans? So this is going to take us to our second bet. First of all, we're both going to take the Titans here. Also, the Titans minus 3.5, I think, is the play, right?
I mean,
good teams and well-coached teams that get humiliated always come out with a fire under them. And I think Jacksonville...
And they're going to roll.
Jacksonville also got humiliated, but I don't think they're as talented. I don't think they're as well-coached. I think that's the difference.
Definitely not as well-coached.
And so I think Vrabel's intensity off that sort of loss is gonna outmatch Jacksonville a little bit, to be quite honest with you. I think they're more of a finesse team, and I think the physicality and the anger that they're going to play with is just going to totally outmatch Jacksonville.
Yeah, I think so, too.
All right, let's go with Kansas City at Denver. That's a no-brainer. We're both going to take Kansas City. I would
show me what Denver does well.
Nothing. They don't do anything well. Well, I mean, their defense is good, but that's it. And that's not going to matter against Kansas City because they're going to get there. They're going to get their 30, and that's it.
Yeah, their defense is decent. That's as much praise as I'll give them.
All right, here's one of our splits. Tampa Bay at San Francisco. So you're going to go ahead and take Tom in Tampa Bay.
Yep.
I would assume because you don't know how you feel about Brock Purdy.
Think Brock Purdy's beating Tom Brady?
I'm going to roll with it. I'm going to take Brock Purdy to beat Tom Brady. I'm not sure how good I feel about it, but I'm going to roll with it. But I will say, though, this is another one of our bets. I think Tampa Bay plus 3.5 has good value. Although I like San Francisco, I think Tampa Bay getting points, that's pretty good.
Well, and
I think
I like if San Francisco... Outright.
Yeah, I mean, you like them outright, but I think plus 3.5, even if they don't win, I think they keep it close enough, lose like by that. 2-3 points.
Yeah.
So I think that's a decent bet. So that's our third bet, Tampa plus 3.5.
I mean, all means, Tom Brady's not going to get blown out by a rookie quarterback Mr. Irrelevant. So.
I don't think so. Panthers at the Seahawks. We're both going to take Seattle. This is our fourth bet here. Seattle minus 3.5 versus Carolina. I just think they're a better team.
Yeah.
I mean, who's starting this week for Carolina? Is it P.J. Walker? Is it Sam Darnold? I honestly have no idea.
I think it's Sam Darnold. I think he's going to probably ride it out, but I'm not.
I really have no idea.
Either way.
I don't think it matters. That's my point. I think minus 3.5 versus Carolina, I think they win by about a touchdown.
Yeah.
Another one of our splits here, Chargers hosting the Dolphins. I'm going to go ahead and take the Dolphins. You're going to take the Chargers.
Yeah.
Look, I just think, look, it's Brandon Staley's defensive head coach. Their defense is terrible. It's not good. And you have Khalil Mack and J.C. Jackson, and they can't generate a pass rush or stop anyone on the back end. And how are you going to expect, first of all, they've always been awful against the run the last, like, 5 years. So they can't stop the run. And we know that that play action in Miami is deadly. And so if you can't cover normally, let alone on play action, I don't know how you're going to deal with the Dolphins.
I mean, I just like Jay Herb. And I think this is going to be a huge coaching matchup, though.
I think so, too. And I don't think Brandon Staley's a better coach.
I don't think so either, but I think it's going to be super competitive. And I think there's more talent in the...
You think there's more talent in L.A.?
Certainly in the quarterbacks. And I'm going to ride with the best quarterback here. I'm going to go Jay Herb and the Chargers.
This is our fifth and final bet as well. We're going to sweat the over on 52.5. It's a primetime game, and primetime unders have been smacking. But there's no defense on either team here. So I think 52.5, we'll sweat it together. Hopefully it hits. And finally, Monday Night Football. We are also split on this one. You'll take the Cardinals at home. I'm going to go ahead and take the Patriots to come in. First of all, I don't know the health of Kyler, so that's a concern for me. And also, look, Mac Jones has looked at least a little bit better the last couple weeks. Last week he was barking. That's fine. Again, good coaches off a kind of accumulating experience, right? Your quarterback's barking at you a little bit. Might bring a little extra fire. I'm just going to roll with a better defense. I don't feel great about the pick. One of those where I got to try to be different and steal an edge here to kind of put you away in the prediction standing. So that's kind of the point of that pick. But I could see that going either way. It's a point and a half game towards the Cardinals. Hey, that's a coin flip for me. I'll flip the coin and land on the Patriots. That's about it.
I like the Cards if they can actually play some, you know, good offensive football and not kind of just sit back on their heels
That's a lot to hope for, man.
Oh, I know, but I think they have if there's like five or six teams in the league that I think could scheme to beat Bill Belichick just by doing crazy things like Kyler and the Cardinals can do.
You think it's okay? That's
and
cool.
I think that's one of the teams.
If Kyler is super talented.
If he can play his game.
That's valid. So let's run back through our bets. We got the Vikings plus 114 on the money line, the Titans minus 3.5 versus Jacksonville, Tampa plus 3.5 at San Fran, Seattle minus 3.5 versus Carolina, and the over on 52.5 in the Chargers-Dolphins game on Sunday Night Football. So those are our five bets on a budget, and we have our three splits. We'll see who gets the dub this week.
Yeah, it'll definitely be interesting. But let's get into something now. We have another rant. The college football world has been crazy, right? It's just we've seen so much on Instagram, on Twitter. Everything's blowing up with transfer portal and, Dion to Colorado Boulder. So right. Let's get into some of that. I know you had something.
Right. I don't want to preface this by saying it's been crazy, right? So everyone wants to be super impatient, right? And that's fine. I get it. That's the transfer portal. That's NIL. I get the culture, shift. But a little bit of patience, right? You got to see these coaches and these players develop. And so I guess that's where we'll start. We'll start with Dion going to Colorado, and then I'll get into all that. So Dion is now the head coach of the Colorado Buffalo. So Colorado, in good hands, I would say, right? I'm not sure about Dion's X's and O's. I mean, it was Jackson State, right? We don't know exactly, right? But I'll tell you what, he's going to bring talent. Right, according to him, he's, quote, bringing luggage and it's Louis, right? Like, he's bringing the dudes. But I think this is going to invoke a lot of criticism and, a lot of people changing, in the transfer portal and coaches going here and there, right? And I know a lot of people, especially those who are really, like, strapped to tradition, they're not going to like this. They're not a fan. So I want to take this moment to speak to one of those people that probably aren't very smart. They must be rigid and, to be quite honest, dumb. I'm just going to say it, actually. Brian from YouTube, welcome. You are my first victim. You are an idiot. You're just not smart. You're not smart, right? And I feel comfortable saying that to you because, well, you came at me personally, right? Like, I love when people comment, but don't come at me, right? Like, let's keep it about the content. Don't come at me. Or you kept it about the content at first, then you came at me, right? So I'm going to come at you, and then I'm going to hit you with facts and make you look even stupider. Can you say a stupider word? Whatever. More stupid. Maybe I'm dumb as well, but not as dumb as you. Anyway. And Brian, before you say anything, shut your mouth. Shut your mouth for a second. Shut your mouth. Who has almost 2,000 on YouTube? Not you. Not you. Okay? Who has over a million views? Not you. Not you, Brian. Not you. All right? And who has an entire segment on a real legitimate podcast, by the way, top 20%. Thank you, Spotify. Wrapped, what's up? Has an entire segment of hits and misses in which I outline explicitly where I'm right about major things. Okay, so now before you say anything, just remember that stuff, okay? You should go watch it. You need to probably learn a thing or two. So, Brian, let's take part one of your rant, right? Big paragraph comment, right? You say Harbaugh lost 5 straight to OSU. Okay, fair. So you're referencing 2015 through 2019. That's five games. So college football genius here, Brian, right? Expert Brian. Did you think to research it? Of course not. Of course you didn't. Why would you? So let's look at what Harbaugh was working with. Let's just look at recruiting classes. Let's start in 2012. And here's why. Because by 2015, those are the juniors and seniors that are actually contributing, right? It's not like basketball where there's a lot of one-and-dones. You'll get the occasional one-and-done, but it's mostly juniors and seniors contributing. So we'll start in 2012. Michigan 6th, Ohio State 5. Michigan 4, Ohio State 2. Michigan 20th, Ohio State 3. Michigan 37th, Ohio State 7. Michigan 7, Ohio State 4. Michigan 5, Ohio State 2. 22-2, 10-7, 12-5, 13-2. You get the point, right? That's all the way up through 2019. You get my point, right? Harbaugh did lose to Ohio State with a bad culture inherited by Brady Hoke and clearly less talent. It's right there. Significantly less talent, Brian. He still doesn't even have his ideal talent. He still isn't pulling the recruits he wants, and he's still waxing the floor with Ohio State in the last couple years. Waxing the floor. It's not even been competitive in the last 5 minutes of the game. That's called coaching. That's called coaching, Brian. Right? Imagine if he also got 7 5-stars walking right into his program yearly, right? Like Ryan Day does. No, he's got like 2 to 3. No, 2 to 3. Ryan Day's got like 7, 8, 9, 10 every single year walking right into his building. He could field almost an entire side of the ball with just 5-stars. Seriously. That's called coaching. How you can take lesser players and beat better players. Right? It's called scheming and coaching and culture. Next thing you say is, oh, the Vikings didn't want him. I guess that's fair, but who said he wanted them all that much? Sure, I mean, he showed interest, right? But let's also look, very comfortable in Michigan. Finally, he's got a really good staff assembled. He's comfortable with the staff. He's got momentum against Ohio State. He's near his family. He's already played in Michigan. He's comfortable there. And doesn't have to deal with an NFL locker room. That's a difficult locker room to deal with right there. There's a reason that not a lot of coaches make it at the next level. Be careful trying to get happier than happy. Right, he was happy there. And finally, for some reason, Brian, I don't understand this one because this is where you really went off the rails. You jump right to Brian Kelly, which is fine because I guess I referenced him in the video, but let's keep it out one thing at a time for future reference. You apparently disagree with my take that Brian Kelly's a really good coach. So let's check that part out. I'm like laughing because it's actually crazy. So let's start with his first job. He goes to Central Michigan. So they were 3-8 before he took over. 3-8. He takes them to 4-7, 6-5, 9-4. Yeah, that seems like that worked out from 3-8 to 9-4 in just 3 years. I got it. So then he leaves for Cincinnati, inherits a 4-7 team. 10-3, 11-3, 12-0. 12-0. 3 years, 12-0. How about Notre Dame? 3-7, 7-6, 6-6, toxic culture with Charlie Weiss. Those are 3 years prior to he got there. Nah, he'll fix it. 8-5, 8-5, 12-1. National championship, 12-1. Ends with one losing season in 11 years. 11. In Notre Dame, where you half of your recruits, actually I would say even over half, 75% of your recruits can't even get in because of the academics. Look who LSU was. They're 6-7. Yeah, Ed Ogeron was not the best coach. Recruiting was shaky. No, they're 9-4. They went to the SEC championship game. Brian, you're a fool. You're an absolute fool, buddy. I mean, look, it's fine to be wrong. But I mean, like, let's learn. Let's adapt. Let's learn and grow together, Brian. So I'm excited to see what point you have to comment on this one, right? Go look at Harbaugh's recruiting. Go look at, I don't know, every stop that Brian Kelly's been at. Actually, if you don't think Harbaugh's that good of a coach, go look at every stop he's been at. San Diego turned that around. How about he goes to the NFL, the harder place to coach, right? San Francisco. That's right. They just went to a Super Bowl. It's nothing crazy. They just went to a Super Bowl. That's right. And then I just showed you what he did with Michigan. All right, he's a good coach. And so any slander for Harbaugh, not with it. Not with it. Unless you back it up with facts. Back it up with facts. Yeah, besides your lost five straight, go look at what he's dealing with. Back it up with facts. Do some research, Brian. You come back to me. For now, though, let's step off, buddy. Step off, all right? Because you're not smart, and don't tell me that I don't know college football and that I'm just, quote, looking at box scores. Because I'm not. I'm not. I just had about 57 tabs open called doing real research, right? Because it's what I do, all right? So, you don't know the... I don't know, Brian. You show me your 2,000 on YouTube. I mean, you show... I think whatever it is, 1.85. Brian, you show me that. God, got me heated.
I mean,
my boy thinks he can come up here.
If we learned anything, it's that you don't make personal attacks on the show unless you have some really good facts to back it up, because you're just going to get buzzsawed on here.
Sorry to do it to you, Brian, but also not sorry.
Hey, sometimes they deserve it, though, you know?
No, Brian, 100% deserved it. 100% deserved it. So,
well, he got his fair share of people firing back in the comments.
Oh,
anyway.
People were firing back at him. Yeah, they're not happy.
As they should. That's the they're issue nation happy. Right there.
Also, there was another comment. I forget who. Somebody was like, oh, Harbaugh's definitely not owning the transfer portal on the NIL. Like, what are you talking about? Like, our NIL stuff is, like, so far behind. Didn't they just steal 2 5-stars from Ohio State?
As soon as they beat Ohio State, they had 2 5-star recruits flip from Ohio State to Michigan. On the day.
I don't know. Looks like they're doing pretty good with their young crowd.
Yeah, so.
I think they're doing okay.
They're on the right track.
They're doing okay. So step off. How about it?
Yeah, I mean.
Try that on for size, pal.
We appreciate the comment, though.
We do.
If you're going to comment in paragraph form. If you're going to comment in paragraph form like that, break it up. Make some separate comments so that way, you know, it improves the comment number, so that way we get some more distribution.
Yeah, that'd be nice.
That way we can
Brian, help out the boys.
Have more people see that you are just absolutely wrong. But that is all we have for today's show. It was a good one. Got heated there and fiery towards the end, which we love, keeping the energy up the entire time. But yeah, come back next week. We will have another great show. Follow us on social media in the meantime, and make sure you go and subscribe to the Issue newsletter. You can find all of that on theissuesports.com, especially for the newsletter. Go on there, type the email in. It's right on the homepage right there. Click sign up. It is that easy to stay up to date with the show. And then our Instagram, obviously, everything is in the link tree or on the website. In the description, wherever you are listening or watching this. And yeah, we appreciate it, guys. So, you know, keep liking, keep commenting, and subscribing. We appreciate it. And that was The Issue.